Hello everyone, this is Alexandre Nolin speaking, co-author with Magnus Haldorsson of this paper about distributed coloring. In this paper we bring quite a few coloring results from local to congest using a technique that's a construction of pseudo-random sets to efficiently communicate large sets of colors, and I hope you'll enjoy it. So first, a bit of definition. The setting we are in is a congest model. So in this model, communication happens along the edges of a graph, and the computing agents are nodes of said graph. There are at most n nodes, and the degree is bounded by a commonly known constant delta. Communication is synchronized, that is, the time goes by in rounds, and in each round, each node can send a message to each of its neighbors, and the messages are sized at most log n, so where n, I recall, is the number of nodes in the graph. That's the congest model. The local model is exactly the same, except that the messages can be of arbitrary size. So in this model, what we consider is coloring problems, and in particular the 2 delta minus 1 edge coloring problem. In this problem, what happens is that you start from a fully uncolored graph, and at the end you want each edge to get assigned a color between 1 and 2 delta minus 1, such that the color it gets is different from the color given to the edges that are adjacent to this edge, that is, that share a common endpoint. And we're interested in the randomized complexity, so that is, we want an algorithm that takes the fewest number of rounds, and we want the failure probability to be less than 1 over polynomial in n. And an execution would look something like this. First you have each node do a bit of computation, then send messages, then do a bit of computation, then maybe some edges get assigned some colors while the nodes send each other messages, and this goes on for a while until all the edges are colored at the end properly. So in this talk I'm really going to mostly talk about the 2 delta minus 1 edge coloring, and a few years ago Elkin, Petit and Su showed that you can do randomized coloring of the edges of a graph with 2 delta minus 1 colors in only log star n rounds, granted that the maximum degree of the graph, the bound you have on it, delta, is more than log n, like slightly more than log n. Log star n is very fast, it's an iterated log, so you know the number of times you need to apply log to n to get to a constant, so it's extremely fast. And so what I want to show you is how to get this result into congest. And all the very fast coloring algorithm, that is, all the algorithm in log star n rounds using randomness, usually use this idea from this paper of Schneider and Wattenhofer of trying multiple colors at the same time. So what do I mean by that? By trying a color, I mean that an edge picks a color at random in the color still available to it, sends this color to its neighbors, and if none of its neighbors is picked the same color in this round, then it keeps the color for itself and permanently colors itself with this color. More formally, and so the idea of trying multiple colors is just to say to do the same thing, except you take a set of colors, and if the sets of color picked by your neighbors do not contain one color you picked, then you can pick this color for yourself and permanently color yourself with it. So for each edge E, consider its life degree, so the number of neighbors that are uncolored. Consider its palette psi E to be the, you know, the subset of the set from 1 to 2 delta minus 1 of colors that are not yet taken by a neighbor, and consider its slack to be the difference between the two, the size of the palette and the life degree. What Schneider and Wattenhofer showed is that if the ratio between the two is large enough, say if the palette is at least 2x times the life degree for each edge, then if you have each edge try x color at random, and keep the color if none of it, keep a color if none of its neighbor is trying it. Well, then each edge gets colored with probability at least 1 minus 2 to the minus x. So failure probability at most 2 to the minus x. So if you were able to, for instance, try log n colors by filling this, satisfying this condition at the beginning, then you would be able to color each edge with high probability using this procedure. The proof is very simple. You just count the number of colors tried by your neighbors. You notice that it is at most half the size of your palette. Therefore, when you try random colors in your palette, each of them has a success probability of at least half. So the probability that all of them fail is at most 2 to the minus x. But for this to work, you need to have a large degree to a large palette size to degree ratio. So you need the palette size to be higher than your life degree. This can be a given if you just assume that you have more colors than you have neighbors from the beginning. That's a problem, coloring problem you can consider. But if you want to not assume that, one thing you can do is actually create this ratio between the two, create slack. That is the difference between the difference of the two when you have what we call sparsity. So what is sparsity? To get some intuition, consider this graph and say that we want to color the nodes here. So since the graph here is completely colored, if you do a partial coloring of this graph, so you color every outside vertex, not the central one, well, you notice that, each of the nodes needs to take a different color because all of them are connected. So as you color the graph, you're not going to create slack for the central node. You're not going to give more choice to the central node because you have color redundancies in its neighborhood. On the other hand, if the neighborhood is fully disconnected, you could have something like this happen, where all the neighbors of the central node pick the same color, or more realistically, maybe some of his neighbors take the same color, and so you have some redundancy in the color picked by the neighbors, and so the central node has more choice when it wants to color itself down the line. Of course, this also works if you, instead of something fully disconnected, you have a good fraction of the edges missing. And more formally, if you define this quantity, the sparsity of a node, by the number of missing edges in its neighborhood divided by delta, well, what Elki, Petty, and Sue showed, like this paper I mentioned before, is that each node gets slack proportional to its sparsity with a probability that is 1 minus some exponential involving this sparsity of the node. And so, in particular, if you consider the edge coloring problem, and you consider the line graph of the edge coloring problem, so each edge becomes a node, and you connect two nodes if the edges that made those nodes share an endpoint. The line graph, the graph you're creating has a sparsity. Each node in it has a sparsity proportional to the maximum degree of the graph. So if delta is at least log n, what you get is that all the nodes with all the edges in an edge coloring problem get slack proportional to the maximum degree with high probability. If you just have each edge try a random color at the beginning of the algorithm. So this already gives us an algorithm for 2 delta minus 1 coloring. So simply, you just have each edge try a random color that creates slack by the previous lemma. Then you have each edge try a random color for a constant number of rounds. Thus increases the palette size to degree ratio to an appropriate constant, so that we can go to step 3 and apply the lemma I showed before of trying multiple colors. And so basically what happened in step 3 is that in each iteration you increase the ratio of palette size to degree from the iterated exponential of 2 by x to the iterated exponentiation of 2 by x plus 1. So the ratio of palette size to degree increases exponentially in each iteration of this loop. And once you've done with this loop, you can say that each edge is either got colored or with high probability has a palette size to degree ratio of at least log n, so each edge can try log n colors and so gets colored with high probability, which is summarized in this. So step 1 and 2 work with high probability as long as delta is at least log n. Step 3 works with high probability if delta is at least log n squared. And in total, what happens is that this is a log star n step algorithm in local for 2 delta minus 1 coloring that works with high probability as long as delta is at least log n squared. Unfortunately, it's not clear how you would do step 3 and 4 in congest, contrary to local, right? Because in step 3 and 4, you have each edge try up to log n colors in a round. And communicating log n colors naively takes log n times log delta bits, so at least log delta rounds. How would you do, so how do you overcome this? And to overcome this, let's first get a bit of intuition from public randomness. So suppose all the nodes had access to a shared source of randomness, and that the palettes are of size at least a fraction of all possible colors, which is the case if you generated stack. So here, let's think a little bit about how you could communicate random colors to your neighbors. So naively, you could still send log delta bits to your neighbors to communicate a color in 1 to 2 delta minus 1. But with public randomness, what you can do is say, well, let's take a subset of the public randomness as a color stream, a stream of colors, and let's indicate the first color in this stream that is in my palette. Since on average, since there is a fraction p of all possible colors that is each edge palette, each color has a probability p of being in the palette, and so on average you're going to take one of the p bits to send a color that way. Much more efficient than log delta. And similarly, if you want to send log n colors, instead of sending log delta times log n bits, you can just make an array of bits that indicates for each color in the stream whether you're sending it or not for the first 1 over p times log n colors. And that's an efficient way to send log n colors. So if you have a shared source of randomness, if you have this common known random source, you can do this task way more efficiently. And the crucial thing here to understand is that the edges do not really need to choose the color they try. They just need the choice to be random, right? And to be in the palette. But they don't really need to choose. Of course, if you want to send an arbitrary color, you need to send log delta bits. But if you're okay with the first color that comes along, as long as it's random, you don't need to use as much bits of communication. And so why I mentioned public randomness, that's something that is completely unnatural to assume in distributed computing. Well, it's because in communication complexity there is a seminal result of Newman that says that if you have an algorithm that works with public randomness, you can turn it into an algorithm that works with private randomness with a small additional cost. So it's very well known result in communication complexity. The idea is quite simple. It's just that you say sparsify the randomness. So that is, if you consider all possible states of the randomness, you know that on any given input, most random string lead to the correct result. And so you say that, well, sampling random states of the randomness in all possible states of the randomness is going to give you a subset of all possible randomness that should be mostly correct as well on each input. And so you can actually say by a standard probabilistic argument that you can find a subset of all possible randomness that's going to work on all possible inputs. So we would like to do something similar here. Unfortunately, of course, we cannot really do something completely similar. Like we cannot have a node pick, you know, randomly choose the public randomness for all of the nodes and send that to them as they do in a communication complexity, the two-party setting. But we can, let's keep the core idea of doing, of trying to do with log n bits of randomness what naively could take more, using a probabilistic method type argument. And so we do this with this thing we call representative sets. So I'm not going to, you know, explain every bit of the definition here. It is very intuitive, actually. So suppose you have a universe of size k, and that you have a large subset of this universe, t, of size delta times k. So it's a constant fraction of the whole universe. Suppose then you take a random set s, for example, of size log n in the whole universe, and you take it fully at random. Then the expected intersection of this set with the large subset t is delta times log n, right? And if you know, if by concentration you can actually argue that the intersection you get is close to this expectation with high probability, granted that you're using sets that are large enough and so on, right? So what we do here is say, instead of taking a set fully at random, we take a family of sets such that if you take one set in the family, it's going to have the same property. That is, the intersection of any set in the family with like a random large subset is going to be about of the size you would expect from a fully random set. And the nice thing being that the random family is much, we define, is much smaller than the, you know, total number of possible sets. So sending the index of one set in the family is way more efficient than sending the description of a fully random set. That's the basic idea. And so we show that such representative sets exist with, you know, some specific parameters here. Importantly, we use it with some specific instantiation of these parameters. So basically, we are saying that there is a family of size polynomial in n of subsets, where each subset is of size log n, such that if you take one of these sets at random with high probability, so probability 1 minus 1 over poly n, the intersection of the set you picked is of the size you would expect if you were to pick a fully random set of the same size with any large subset of the whole universe, where the whole universe here is a set of colors. So from that we get a way to efficiently try multiple colors in a constant number of congest rounds. So what we do is on each edge, you have one of the endpoint pick a random representative set, send it index to the other endpoint. Then the two nodes tell to each other which colors in the representative set are already used by neighboring edges. So this is essentially finding out which part of the representative set intersects the palette of the edge. And since you know that the palette of the edge represents a constant fraction of the whole universe of colors, by the representative set property, you get that this intersection is going to be of size order log n with high probability, right? Because we know that a representative set should have an intersection with any large subset of about the size you would expect if you were to pick a set fully at random. So these two steps allow us to sample colors in the palette of an edge. And then you have one of the endpoints pick X color at random in the palette colors we just sampled, send that to the other, and then check if the colors picked here intersect or are tried by neighboring edges. And same thing, the representative set property tells us that tells us that the representative set should have large intersection with the set defined as the palette of the edge to which you remove the colors tried by the neighbors. And therefore, when you pick X color at random in the set previously constructed, each of them should have a constant probability of success. And so the probability that you picked a color that is not tried by any neighboring edge is a probability that looks really like what we had before, 1 minus 2 to the minus x times the constant. So you just have this additional, you have this small loss. It's no longer 2 to the minus x, but it's 2 to the minus x times a constant. So it's still quite good. And so each edge color itself with such a color if it exists. And the nice thing here is that all the steps can be done in log n bits, so that is in a constant number of congest rounds. Now, the first step where you send the index of a representative set works in log n bits because you know that the representative set family is of size polynomial in n. And for all the other steps, well, notice that we are basically communicating subsets of the representative set picked in the first step. But since the representative set picked in the first step is of size log n, you can just send log n bits to indicate for each element in the representative set whether you're taking it or not. So log n bits suffice to specify a subset of this representative set. So you can just communicate in log n bits for all of the steps. And this simple procedure means that the algorithm I presented before that worked in local also works in congest just by using this procedure to try up to log n color in a constant number of rounds. We qu have quite a few other results. What I said for edge coloring can be done for vertex coloring if you assume either that the vertices have sparsity or that you allow more colors than is strictly necessary. With a few other techniques, we can also get a slightly better result where we just use 1 plus epsilon times delta colors for edge coloring. We also get a bound that our algorithm also work with delta doesn't really need to be log n squared as I said before, but you actually just need log 1 plus some constant, for example. We also get algorithm for when delta is smaller using a shattering technique and some deterministic algorithm. Finally, I should mention that recently with Magnus and another call for Tigran Tonoyan, we put a work on archive in which we use a technique that is kind of an extension of what I just presented, the representative set. And that just gives all these results for list coloring for free, essentially, right? If you're interested in that, here's a link. Thanks for your attention. If you're interested in the full paper, here is the archive link. And if you're interested in one of the paper I mentioned during the talk, here's a bit of bibliography on which you can pause the video. Thanks.